All right, we're looking at a left coxal bone. A lot of times you hear many different terms associated with your hip bone. Hip bone is a good term to use. Coxal bone, os coxa, inanimate, they all mean the same thing. So you would have, in terms of the pelvic girdle, you would have a left coxal bone, a right coxal bone on this side, and then the sacrum would be back here. Now, when you talk about a coxal bone, you really separate it into three different areas. And they were three different bones, actually, in terms of a juvenile adult or juvenile individual. In an adult, they actually fuse together in this acetabulum. So you have your ischium, which is the largest of the three, your pubic bone, which is the anteriorly placed, and then the ischium, which is the more posteriorly placed. So ischium back here, pubis right here, ilium here. So ilium you can think of as kind of the flank in terms of your hip. When you put your hands on your hip, you're putting it right around this region right here. And this region right here is referred to as the iliac crest. So your abdominal muscles are actually going to attach right here, or have some level of attachment here. Now, the most anterior portion is referred to as your ACIS. You'll hear that a lot in terms of clinical talk. Stands for anterior superior iliac spine. So your inguinal ligament is going to come from here to about here. So your pubic tubercle to your ACIS. So inguinal ligaments play an important role in terms of your inguinal canal. So the spermatic cord will travel through there, as well as the round ligament of the uterus is going to travel through the inguinal canal. And that inguinal ligament is going to be the bottom portion of the inguinal canal. So that's the iliac crest right here. Now, if I were to turn this a little more internally, you would see this fairly prominent portion right here. This is referred to as the articular surface. This is where the sacrum is going to attach. So to get that really stable joint between the sacrum, which is part of your vertebral column, and the actual coxal bone. So this is actually an area that I used a lot in terms of forensic anthropology. You can look at this area. It breaks down in a very definite manner, so a very timely manner, and you can actually estimate age of an individual at death. So that's your articular surface there. An even better area to use is right here in terms of your pubic symphysis. So where the other pubic bone is going to attach with this pubis bone, you'll have your pubic symphysis. So very important in terms of a cartilaginous joint. You'll actually have relaxing of this joint during labor and delivery. And if you look right in here, this we refer to a lot of times as the pubic symphyseal plate or face. And this will actually break down in a very timely manner as well. So this is the best area in terms of determining age at death in adults. All right, so let's look at a few other dominant things in terms of your coxal bone. Right here, this is your obturator foramen. This is the largest foramen of the body. So you'll have one on either coxal bone. This actually, during life, is completely occluded with connective tissue. So you have connective tissue throughout the entirety of the foramen, except for a little small hole to allow for obturator neurovasculature to move through there. So obturator nerve will play a role in terms of innervating the abductors of your thigh. So completely occluded during life. Another thing I want you to note right here is this large notch. You have a very large nerve that's actually going to move through this region in order to completely innervate everything in terms of the lower limb, other than for the obturator nerve. This notch is referred to as the greater sciatic notch, and as the name would suggest, your sciatic nerve is going to travel through the notch. This is actually a sexually dimorphic area as well. Males tend to have much more angular, greater sciatic notches, so it looks much more like a triangle, not as wide of an angle, whereas females typically have much wider, greater sciatic notches. So whenever I was trying to estimate sex of an individual, this is one of the first areas I would look at. Now, on this bottom portion of the obturator foramen, we have what's referred to as the ischiopubic ramus. So you'll have a portion of your pubis bone connecting with a portion of your ischium to form this inferior border of the obturator foramen. There are a lot of muscles that attach here. Some portions of the connective tissue associated with external genitalia will also attach in this region. All right, two more things I want to note. When you're thinking most posteriorly, you'll have this very thickened portion of bone referred to as the ischial tuberosity. If you think about sitting down, you're basically sitting on these ischial tuberosities. Your hamstring muscles are going to attach here, so that's why it's so built up. Those muscles are very robust, very strong muscles, so you have a large portion of mounding right here. And probably the most prominent thing in terms of the coxal bone is your acetabulum. So the acetabulum, quite deep in comparison to its counterpart in the shoulder joint, or your glenoid fossa or glenoid cavity, which is quite shallow. So if you think about the femoral head, or the femur head fitting in here, it's a much better fit, leading to a much more stable hip joint than you have with the shoulder joint. But both are examples of ball and socket joints. So the femoral head will fit here. This is where the ilium, the ischium, and the pubis have all fused.